Good morning. Welcome to Calvary at Lake Zion. We're so glad you've come to join us here, either in person or by way of Facebook Live. We want you to feel very welcome here. I know we already have guests today. Guests, you are our special people today. Thank you for coming to share this time with us. We hope that you'll all enter into the service, pray, giving, and especially responding to God's Word. David is coming now to lead us in our scripture passage.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Let me ask you to please rise and hear God's Word. We're coming from Psalm 150, ESV version. Let everything praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary.
Amen.
Praise Him in His mighty heavens. Praise Him for His mighty deeds. Praise Him according to His excellent greatness.
Amen.
Praise Him with trumpet sound. Praise Him with the lute and harp. Praise Him with the tambourine and dance. Praise Him with strings and pipe. Praise Him with sounding cymbals. Praise Him with loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Praise
Yes.
the Lord.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Even when things are not working.
Good morning, Calvary family. Just a couple of announcements. We just finished the Rikers study, so if you weren't able to make it here at 9:15 a.m., we encourage you to do so. It's such a blessing to be able to be a part of a group, just to fellowship with others, and just to hear the support and the encouragement from one another. Also, I'd like to share that we just had our women's study yesterday. Again, that's another blessing to be able to gather with our women and just to hear, to have prayer. We pray together, we praise together, and that's a beautiful blessing that we also have here at Calvary. And two, with the men's, women's, if you're interested, please get with Francis or Anna or Barbie for more information. For the men's, please get with David or Victor for more information. We are having a Christmas couple dinner, so please make plans with your spouse December 18th to make it out here and join us for dinner. We will have a white elephant game and other fun that we have lined up for the couples. So please make plans December 18th to join us for dinner. That's it.
Yeah.
Thank
you.
Worship.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, we're going to praise and worship Jesus Christ this morning, no matter what.
Amen.
No matter what. We praise you. Hallelujah. Let's get this party started.
Amen.
Thank you.
God does as well. the sweetest thing, the sweetest moment, the sweetest time that you can have with your spouse is right here. The sweetest time, the sweetest moment you can have with your children or your grandchildren right here. On knees. Your children, man, they'll remember that. They'll remember up until their adulthood. Oh, I remember being on my knees with my mom, or my dad, or my parents. Is this thing even out? You need to make it. Let's come to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. Lord, we give you glory, we give you honor, we give you praises, we give you thanks. Because you are worthy of our praises, Lord. No matter what goes on in our lives, you are worthy. We just want to take a moment and say thank you to you, for who you are, and for all that you are. Thank you that you are our God. Even when things don't turn out the way that we want them to turn out, we thank you. We love you this morning, Father. Thank you for this new day, a day we've never seen before, a day we'll never see again. But yet you allowed us to wake up today. So we just pray, Lord God, that we might accomplish the purpose that you have in our will, in your will for us today. Whatever that is, however it looks like, we pray that we might accomplish that purpose. So Father, here we are on bended knees, whether physically or spiritually, here we are before your throne. Father, we just pray that you would hear the cries of the hearts of your people. For many of us, we have different things going on in our lives. We have different petitions, but God, we know that you hear them all the same. We know that you are able to not only hear us individually, but you are more than able to answer us. We thank you, Lord God. We thank you for the marriages that we have. We thank you for our families, our children. We thank you for our grandchildren. God, we thank you for our jobs. We thank you for our homes, our transportation. We thank you for our salvation. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the Holy Spirit who lives in us and guides us and empowers us. We thank you, Father God, that we're able to come to church freely to worship you corporately. We thank you, Lord, for where you have us right now, today. And God, we just give you glory, we give you honor. We know that nothing catches you by surprise, not even when things don't sink. God, we are still going to praise you. We're still going to worship you. You know, we lift up the devil. He's having back surgery tomorrow. God, we pray that it's successful. We pray that your presence is there with her. We pray that she knows it beyond the shadow of a doubt, that you are there with her. And God, we pray that you use this time, use the process to minister to her. Let her know that she's not alone. She's not by herself. God, we thank you for everyone that's here this morning, for those that are tuning in by way of Facebook Live. God, we thank you that we have that avenue to spread your word, to have church when others that cannot be here. And again, Lord, we thank you for everyone here. We pray that we hear a word from on high. That something is said or something is done, as we needed to hear your word. We needed that touch.
All we're hearing now is this back monitor, guys.
The Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord
rejoicing, he is with you, he is for you.
as those that are engaged, really engaged. So
I'm shocked though, not just keeping it, not just hanging on, engaged. Maybe not even, no, maybe. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. Lord, we give you glory and honor. We give you praises and thanks, Father God, because you are worthy of our praises. God, we just ask that you might be glorified here and now. Always, not only here at the church, but in our personal lives. God, that you would be glorified, that you would be magnified. We pray that your word goes out, accomplishing what is set out to do, not returning to you for it. So, Father, move me out of the way, have your way. Speak to our hearts, speak to our spirits. And Father, we pray that we may have come in here one way, but we pray this morning we walk away differently.
Amen.
Because of your touch, because of your word, because of your spirit, and because of your people. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I have a mountain of credit card debt. One man told another. I know where your mind for going there. I lost my job, my car being repossessed, and our house is in foreclosure. But I'm not worried about it, he said. Not worried about it, said his friend. No, I've hired a professional worrier. He does all the worrying for me. That way, I don't even have to think about it. That's fantastic. How much does this professional worrier cost you? $50,000. So, man, $50,000, he said. Where are you going to get that kind of money? I don't know, James replied. It's his word. When you think about it, in a sense, we, God's people, have someone who can worry for us. 1 Peter 5:7 says, cast all your cares, cast all your anxieties over to God because he cares for you. You don't have to worry. So I think today in this message here, maybe you're sitting here, you're thinking, man, Thanksgiving is Thursday. What do I have to give God thanks for? If nothing else, thank him for him.
Amen.
I want you to see you do have a lot to be thankful for. And the title of this message is Give Thanks for All Your Many Blessings. God's coming out of Philippians 4:2-9. Philippians 4. Now you've got to use your Bibles. So I want to hear the babies. And maybe that's why God allowed us not to have any technology. Right? Because he wants us in his word. Because if all fails, guess what? We got his word. And even furthermore, I'd like to say is that don't just have a book, have his word in your heart. Because if something happens to the books, guess what? You still have his word. In your heart, if you're using the Bible in front of you, you have that page number so everybody can be in the same place. Please, that is Philippians 4, and that would be on page 982. Thank you very much. 982 in the Bible that's in front of you. And we're going to be reading 2-9. I'm going to ask you to stand for the reading of God's Word. Again, you have the Bible in front of you. It's ESV. We'll all be reading from the same translation. Let's read as follows. I entreat Eudia, I could be saying that wrong, I entreat Syntyche to agree in the Lord.
Yes, I ask you also, true companion, help these women who have labored side by side with me
in the gospel together with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers, whose names are in the book of life.
Rejoice in the Lord always.
Again, I say rejoice. Let your reasonableness
Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God.
And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding,
will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is any worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard
and seen in me, practice these things, and
the God of peace will be with you.
Amen.
Amen. May you see it. You would have had a PowerPoint with some points, but I'll give it to you. Your first point is in light of verses 2 and 3, and that is a call to unity. A call to unity. In case you're taking notes, I entreat Judea, and I know I'm pronouncing these wrong. I tried to remember the right pronunciation, but wasn't that easy. And I entreat Syntyche, you know there's an it in there, to agree in the Lord. This is the Apostle Paul, obviously writing to the church of Philippi. He's the one who planted this church. Some of you might remember when or about he did that. It was in the early 60s, late 50s, AD, first century. If you guys recall, in Acts chapter 16, he was incarcerated. He got locked up because he was doing the Lord's work. Long story short, while he was there in that area, there were some people who got saved, including the jailer from the jail. But Lydia and all her friends got saved, and that was the first church in Europe. And that was planted by Paul in Philippi. So he's writing about these two women that are in the church of Philippi. And he says that he wants them to agree in the Lord. Now, given people have their different say-sos, right? Their different opinions about something. But what does God have to say? That's the bottom line. That's the final authority. And he says that he wants them to agree in the Lord. Yes, I ask you also, true companion, help these women who have labored side by side with me in the gospel together with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers. Now, this ought to encourage the women because a lot of times the women get a bad rap that they can't do this or they can't do that. They're limited to certain parts of ministry because in Scripture, especially in the original languages, there's a masculine grammar that's being used in many parts of Scripture. So the women could very easily feel like out of place. But here, Paul is being very specific about these ladies and others who labored side by side with me in the gospel together. So they were very impactful in the church of Philippi. And I think some of you ladies here in the 21st century, you know that God is using you here at Calvary Lakeside, that God has been using you at Calvary Lakeside, and he'll continue to use you, given that you continue to make yourself available to be used by God. So I think, again, for the women, that ought to be encouraging to you. Because if you're like the men, and I'm sure you are, because we all have that same spirit, we just want, right? We desire to do something for the Lord. Or, better said, have God do something through me that's going to make an impact for the kingdom. You want to be used. I want to be used. It's a natural thing to want to be used by God because you belong to God. Man, I want to make a difference in someone's lives. So, I really hope that you take this. Ladies, they were a part of the work of the gospel. The gospel that was being preached, the gospel that was being spread. There were co-workers along with Paul and Clement and the rest of the my fellow workers, he says, listen to this, whose names are in the book of life. Now, we can ask a very easy question very quickly. The book of life. Now, I want to encourage you to ask this question. Is your name written in this same book?
Yes,
because there's only one way to have your name written in the book of life. And some of you may not even know what the book of life is. And that's fine. I'll explain it to you real quick. The book of life is when you get saved, when you are converted. Now, there's a debate on two sides of the coin. Some people say God's elect is already in the book of life. And some say that you'll become a part of this book of life until you get saved. I believe the latter. But the important thing is, really not when, is get in there, right? Is make sure that your name is in the book of life. You see this in Revelation chapter 20. And verse 11 all the way to verse 15, there's two books that are open. One book is the book of works, or the book of deeds. And the people were judged based on what or how they lived. Those are the unbelievers who think that they got it all together. Well, and God is just saying, you know, if you guys want to be judged based on what you've done, because I'm a loving God and a just God, I'll judge you based on how you lived your life. How many of us are competent to stand before God based on how you lived your life? I don't see any hands. Then there's another book, and it says that whosoever name was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. So we want our names in this book.
There we go.
So these are saved people. These are people who belong to God. And know that because he's saying these are women who labor side by side with him together in the gospel. They're not only in the book, but they're serving God. In some capacity, they're serving God. So let that be a blessing to you, if nothing else. God loves when his church is operating in harmony. God wants unity in the church. Just as you see Paul is saying, he wants the ladies to be able to agree in what, not what she says or he says, but in the Lord. What does God have to say about it? Let me illustrate it this way. Psalms 133, 1 and 2 says this. Behold, how good and pleasant is it when brothers dwell in unity, or sisters. It is like the precious oil on the head, running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robe. That is the unity of the brother, the unity of God's family. Excuse me. So how does this apply to us? So glad you asked. Let us do everything in our power to be at peace with each other and others. Because God loves unity. I think if the church, folks, people in church, would really take that to heart and be conscientious about being unified, being one the way we ought to be, I think there'll be less people hurt. Because, you know, you have a lot of people who claim, well, I don't go to church anymore because I got hurt. I don't go to, you know, this happened at this time, and because of that, it left a bad taste in my mouth, and therefore, I don't go to church. God wants a unified church, a unified body. We want people in, not out, in the book of life. And I want to point something out very quickly. At the beginning, I entreat Paul starts with. And that is an imperative. And what is an imperative? It's a command. It's a demand. So it's not an option. It is an imperative. Also, in your second point, a call to rejoice. This is in like verses 4 through 7. And Paul says, rejoice in the Lord always.
Yeah.
Now, the word rejoice is actually an imperative. A little weird, right? You're commanding me to rejoice in the Lord, yes. Find your joy in the Lord. Not in people, right? Not in circumstances, not in what's going on around us. But he says, rejoice in the Lord always. In case you missed it the first time, rejoice. He says it twice. That's emphatic. That's the Greek language, is when they repeat after themselves, it's emphatic. They're making a point. They don't want you to miss this. So rejoice.
Yes,
rejoice in the Lord always. Do you know, I know you know this, but do you know that believers, Christians like you and I, we tend to lose our joy somewhere along the process, somewhere within the journey of our Christian life. At some point, it seems like we lose our joy. Sometimes people are, you're just mad. You're walking around mugging each other. You're a believer. Hello. The resurrection power lives on the inside of you. The same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. Don't let the enemy steal your joy. Sometimes we have to remind ourselves, and obviously through the Holy Spirit, but remind ourselves, be joyful where you're at. And sometimes when I'm doing counseling, and some of you already know this because I know it's familiar to you because you hear me talking about it, and I have to stop and do it myself. Being so busy, being so overwhelmed, being busy with school and exams and papers, and stop and remind myself, praise the Lord for where I'm at. Thank you, God, for what I am able to do. So you do really have a lot to be thankful for. So if you fit in that category, stop and remind yourself. Rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord. Because it only gets better, guys, from here. You enter into eternity and be in glory with God forever. So it gets better. Far better than what we experience here in the temporal. It gets better. So remind yourself to rejoice. It says in verse 5, let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. So if the Lord is at hand, if the Lord is on his way back, how shall we be in our demeanor? Come, Lord Jesus. Come. Specimen Marcus is due. Come, Lord Jesus. Come. I mean, we as believers, seriously, we have to be the most joyful people in the world. And sometimes it's not that. That's not the case. Even in a storm, we ought to be the most joyful people in the world. Because what we have, everybody does not have. Not that we're better than everyone, but we're different. We're saved. We're on our way to glory. We are forgiven people. We are redeemed people. We are empowered by the Holy Spirit. Everyone does not have that. And because of that, we can rejoice on a daily basis. Thank you, God. Thank you. We have a lot to be thankful for. And it says in 6, and you'll see the do not, which is command. He's saying, do not be anxious for anything. And what are we all?
Anxious.
You know? Hey, man, I'm just anxious about. Scripture says, do not be anxious about anything. Jesus says in Matthew chapter 6, do not worry about what you will eat or drink or the clothes you wear. he says in 6:33, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things shall be added unto you. So the first thing that he wants us to do is to focus on God, not things. Focus on him. If you belong to him, guess what? He'll take care of you.
Amen. Amen.
He'll take care of you, even in the dry times. I don't see anybody here, excuse me for this term, I don't see anybody here that looks like you're starving to death. So thank God he takes care of his people.
There you go.
Just don't let us go into a drought, because you might be the next 30. I'm kidding. But don't be anxious about anything. I mean, and for some people, I know you find that hard. I mean, in reality, right? Seriously. In reality, I find it hard not to be anxious. I find it hard not to worry. I even worry when I have something to worry about. But again, this is scripture telling us not to be anxious. I mean, there's more, we add more problems into the realm of worrying. Health issues. Faith issues. I can't trust God, so therefore, I'm gonna worry. I'm gonna be anxious over this. And I can tell you this, you've heard me preach this before. You've been with us on Wednesday, you know this is what we're talking about. Where does anxious come from? We start to think. Well, what if? We think of an outcome that hasn't even happened. We think of something that hasn't even taken place. And then we begin to run with it. We become anxious. We lose sleep. We have all kinds of health issues. And all you can think about is what didn't happen yet. And worry about it. Doesn't make sense. It really doesn't. When you look at scripture and Jesus says, do not worry, when Paul is saying to the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, be anxious for nothing. Not your children, not your grandchildren. Don't be anxious about your job, whether you're going to lose it or not. Be anxious for nothing. But instead, he says, pray about everything. With thanksgiving, letting your petitions be made known unto God. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding shall guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. I'm telling you, I wish that I could really paint this in your hearts, because, I mean, obviously I'm a pastor, so I come to many people, and I've come across many, far too many people with anxiety and with believers. That's not saying, wait a minute, and I want you to walk out here and say, well, you know, Pastor said that Christians shouldn't be depressed or get depressed or find themselves being in the blues. That's not what I'm saying. Because everybody, from time to time, finds themselves in the blues. Sometimes it's just our hormones, our physiological body that's just not acting right, and we just kind of find ourselves in a dark place. But the idea is not to stay there.
Yes.
That's the idea. I mean, scripture tells us in the Psalms, over and over, David was in a place where he was in the blues time and time again. But David also says in the book of Samuel that I encouraged myself in the Lord. So don't stay there. Be anxious for nothing, but everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Be able to just thank God for where we're at, for who you are, and for whose you
yes.
are. Thank you, Lord. You don't have to understand everything, but I thank you. You don't have to understand everything that your children might be going through. Thank you, man. Thank you that he has his hands on them. I can almost bet my last dollar you're praying for your children. And if you're praying for your children, why are you? If you weren't, it means you don't trust that God can take care of them. So instead of worrying, instead of being anxious, trade that in for prayer. Go to the Lord. Did you know that that's one of the number one things that Christians don't do on a daily basis is pray. But you know what Christians should do when they're in trouble?
Pray.
Oh God, here I am again. But God wants us to have this communication on a day-to-day basis. Every day. I'll just call on you when I need you. When I do need you, and I don't call them, they're there anyway. You know, that's where God wants us. So to pray with supplication and thanksgiving, let our requests be made known to everyone, and tell everybody else in the world, be on the phone, be on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram, put all your issues up on there, but you've never took it to God. Take it to the Lord. It says, and the peace of God which surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. That is the peace of God. You can be peaceful about the way it is. There's a good way to look at that. If it is God's will, right? For such and such. Not the what if that causes anxiety. It is totally up to God. Let me give you a realistic, quick example. And again, I may have shared this before, something along these lines. I drove to Kansas, thank you for somebody. I drove to Kansas. When did I go?
Friday.
Yesterday. That happens when you're over. So I drove to Kansas now, and I'm no kidding. So as I'm getting in the car, just have these thoughts, I'm not going to come back. Something's going to happen. I'm going to get into a car accident, I'm going to have a heart attack, I'm away. I don't know, I'm going to starve for 10 hours. Roll over and die. But I just had this ugly thought that I won't be back. And I thought about my family, thought about the church. I mean, how would that? Man, the church is going to be a mess. Because I know, you know, y'all love me, I know y'all.
Yeah.
I mean, for something like that to happen, suddenly it would be devastating. And as I'm driving, I say, Lord, the church will be done. However you want to take me, whenever you want to take me, I didn't say this years ago, but I can say it today.
Yes.
God, I'm ready.
Amen.
Whenever you're ready, I'm ready. My only thing is, if something like this happens, let my children, let my wife, let the church get closer to you because of that. In some way, you get the glory.
Amen.
So, you have to shake off the anxiety. You have to shake off the worry. Just give it to God.
Amen.
Because at the end of the day, especially as a believer, your life is in His hands. Let me illustrate this very, very quickly. I know my wife fell 3-4 weeks ago. It was an accident. And she broke her knee. We didn't realize it at first. I was really on my way out. And the kids were already, I was at work. Matthew was in school. And she's saying, you know, just go. I'm like, man, no, I'm not going to go. You're here by yourself. I'm not going to leave you by yourself. So we took her to the ER, and sure enough, it was broken. Now, how do you thank God for a broken knee? You know, thank you for my broken knee, God. No. Thank you, God, that it could have been worse.
Yeah.
She could have fell. This is concrete floor. She could have fell, hit her head on the ground, and have permanent damage. So even in that, you can find ways to be thankful. Be thankful for it. Amen?
Amen.
So what's the application? Let us be thankful in everything. Now I'm not saying be thankful for everything. Thank you that I broke my knee. But be thankful in it.
Yes.
Because it's happened, God, thank you that I know that it could have been worse. And I thank you. Thank you that I'm still here. Number three, a call to obedience. A call to obedience. And it says, finally, brothers, you can almost hear the Apostle Paul, you know, when you say, finally, like you just, you know, you're done. Finally, guys, let me just finish this. I want you to keep in mind, he's in prison. He's in a prison cell. In the first century, not the 21st century, table of three meals a day, and, you know, clean clothes, and provided by the state, hygiene and education, and not at all. He's in a dungeon, possibly chained to the wall or chained to a Roman soldier. So he's in chains. And here he's writing to the church of Philippi. Rejoice! Rejoice in the Lord always. How do you do that? Who does that? A believer does that. Even in the midst of that storm. And then he says, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there's any excellence, if there's any worthy of praise, think on these things. Imperative. Command. There's no option. Remember, he's writing to Christians. So he's saying all these different attributes are all positive, right? He's not talking about positive thinking. You know, I still want to think that way. And although it's a good thing, but keep it alive. The word of God. So you don't want to be called sign of God. Just be this positive thinker. But he's saying whatever is honorable, whatever is true, just, pure, lovely, commendable, all these different things, commandment, think on these things. Why? Because the battlefield is right here. Here is where it starts. You have to. I'm saying this emphatically. You have to be careful with your mind. Because your mind will take you places you never intended for it to go. And some of you who are on the Facebook, you see every 98 to 4 months, I'll put a quote on there. Don't believe everything you think. And I do that purposely because we tend to go back to that way of thinking. And I just wanted to remind people, don't believe everything you think. The best way to clean up your thinking is with the Word of God.
Amen.
The best. The Word of God is a cleansing agent, if you will. Jesus says in the Gospel, speaking to the disciples, you are already clean because of the word that I spoke to you. John 15:3, I believe. So he says, speak on these things. Verse 9, as far as what you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things. Now, practice is pretty obvious, right? Imperative. It's another command. Practice these things. Practice, work on our thinking. Have a change of mind. Begin to think differently. Begin to think with a different perspective in light of God's word. It can be done. Now, is it easy? I'm not saying it's easy. There's some hard work because it's easy just to let your mind, right? It's easy just to let it do whatever it wants to do. But it's hard. It takes effort to keep your mind focused on God. Focused on His Word. Be in His Word every day, allowing God's Word to change your mind, to change your thinking. Many of us have Bibles that are all marked up and falling apart. How about letting the Bible mark you instead of us just marking up the Bible? Let it mark our lives. And then begin to shape our thinking, transform our thinking. And then he says, and the God of peace will be with you. He said, God, this is the way that I live, God. You see me? You've seen the things that you've seen, how I act? You've heard me? Now practice these things. And here he is in a dungeon. chained to the wall or to the Roman soldier. Guys, you know, basically what he's saying is, if I can do this in a jail cell, you can do this out there in the peace of God. I mean, just to have the peace of God, be confident in who you are because of whose you are.
Amen.
That's where we want to be. And evergreen is always green despite the changes of weather around it. It is green in the heat of the summer as well as in the cold of the winter. So also our lives are being characterized by an enduring thankfulness that is unaffected of the change around us. When the heat of the pressure, weak, or the deadly cold of pain strikes us, we should stand evergreen and always be thankful, regardless of that which surrounds us. Now, how do we apply this to our lives? Let us think and ponder on our blessings. If God has done it once, He can do it again. When you find yourself in a situation that you were before, if He's gotten you out of the first one, He's more than able to get you out of that second one. Let me end with the story. There was an eagle's nest above a turkey farm. And it just so happened that one of the eggs fell in the turkey farm. And one of the mother turkeys had her eggs, and she put this egg with the turkeys and sat on it and did all these motherly things that turkeys do. And lo and behold, a patch. This little eaglet thought it was a turkey. This little eaglet tried to wobble, tried to gobble, but found it very difficult and understood that it's got to be in the wrong place. I feel something's wrong here. And one day, an eagle was soaring through the sky. The little eaglet looks out. Wow, I wish I can do that. And this eagle, being very precise, heard and came and flew down. He says, "What are you doing here?" And the eagle says, "Well, I'm hanging with the turkeys." "I'm a turkey." He said, "Who told you you were a turkey?" He says, "You're not a turkey. Flap those wings." And he began to flap. Before you know it, this little eagle was sorry. And then the turkeys looked up, his brothers and sisters. Looked up, "Hey, where are you going?" He says, "I'm going to be what God created me to be, you turkey." As Susan makes her way up here, contemplate on how God is speaking to you. How does He want you to respond to His word? And furthermore, to the Thanksgiving holiday. Are you thankful? Are you rejoicing in the Lord? Because I think that is where He wants you.
Mm-hmm.
have a job. God, this wife you gave me. God, this husband you gave me. Be thankful that you're married. These children, Lord, thank God that he gifted you with children. You can find so many ways and so many things to be thankful for. And one of our ways to be thankful to God is a response of worship. Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you for where I'm at in my life right now. Thank you that I belong to you. I'm going to ask you if you choose to come up here. Together. If not, just get on your knees within your spirit. Let's respond. Father, thank you for who you are. Thank you for all that you are. We know that your word is totally against us being grumblers, being complainers. But God, we know that you would have us to have a thankful heart in everything. Your word tells us to be thankful in everything, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus. So God, give us that desire to be thankful for everything we have, for who we are, for where we're at in life, to find these little things and big things to be thankful for. Most importantly, God, we thank you for you. We love you, praise you, we honor you. God, I understand that some of us really need to repent because we haven't had a thankful heart. But instead, we've been complaining. So, Father, we just pray that you would forgive us in that way. We pray that we would begin to look at things in your perspective. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the Holy Spirit. We thank you for Calvary. We thank you for each other. We thank you for you. We ask these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. I want to come forward and lead us into a prayer of giving. Followed by Susan for our dismissal song. And then Brother Bob's going to come up and we'll say that, brother, and lead us into all our business.
we're singing out the song of worship, Oh Happy Day.
I'll go.
Did we stop that?
You want to stop that?